Well, hello, 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 and welcome once again to 25 O'Clock. I'm your host, Dan Drago. Thanks for being here. Thanks for joining me on the show. Here we are, Philadelphia's longest-running music podcast, I think. It's a fun one this week. It's different. It's not an artist, not a musician, although we do love artists and musicians here at 25 O'Clock. But I do love talking to people who exist in different realms of the music world, in the support realm, in sort of like I consider it kind of like the musical back of house. And so we're talking with Jeremy Garber, who's a co-founder and runs Grind Select, a record label based here out of Philadelphia. Features a ton of Philadelphia bands, a bunch of New York bands, bands from all over. They're a really, really cool record label. And we'll talk more about Jeremy and we'll talk more about Grind Select in just a moment. But as always, if you're new to the show, old to the show, medium to the show, I highly recommend you check out 25oclockpod.com. That's our place out there in the world. And you can do everything there. All the episodes are available for streaming and for downloading, so check those out. You can sign up for the mailing list. I send out an email every time there's a new episode. I let you know what's going on. You can hook up with us on the socials. We're on Instagram. We're on TikTok. We're on Blue Sky. We've got a link tree, which is a tree of links. It is what it is. It's a tree of links, and we have one. Of course, at the website, you can go to the Friends and Neighbors page. I've linked anyone and everyone who's ever been on the show. So if you like an artist and you like what you hear and you want to be able to support them, say you're listening to this episode and you're like, wow, all these bands that Grind Select has had over their 10 years of existence, I want to check more of that out. If you go to the Friends and Neighbors page, just click on the episode link, click on the little thumbnail for this week's episode, and there, I'll take you right to Grind Select, right to their website, their artist roster, how to buy records from them, all that. You could do all that at the Friends and Neighbors page at 25oclockpod.com. I like when you support the artists and music of Philadelphia. I do very much. So yeah, that's the spiel. Grind Select, been a record label for 10 years. I have been getting their emails for probably 7 or 8 of those years. Just in the general, you know, background hum of emails from record labels and PR people. And I don't think I'm insulting anyone. I'm certainly not insulting Jeremy or anyone who works at the label. I ignore most of it. It's just kind of how it goes, because once you kind of, if you're making this kind of thing that we're making here at 25 O'Clock, at a certain level that we're making it right here, you get a lot of great emails from real bands, real people writing you email, telling you about their band, telling you about their music, and really great small labels, again, writing you email, telling you about their bands, telling you about their rosters. And then you get a lot of just weirdo stuff. And so there were definitely periods where I'd forgotten what Grind Select was, and I would just see it pop up in my email notification. I'd be like, the heck is Grind Select? And I would go like a year thinking this. Just be like, I don't know who this is. I don't know how they found me. I don't recognize who this band is. I don't know what's happening. I'm going to move on with my life. And then occasionally they would throw a Philadelphia band in there. They'd be like, oh, here's a new release from the Pine Barrens. Here's a new release from Grocer. And I'd be like, oh yeah, that's where I know these guys from. And then I would remember for a short period of time. And then like a year would go by and I'd get another email. And I'd be like, wait, who are these guys again? That is in no way the fault of the record label and completely the fault of my brain and how I choose to remember things. But yeah, we did mention that. I don't know if we mentioned on the mics or not, but I do mention to him. I said, I've been getting your emails for almost a decade and I haven't unsubscribed. So that's, you know, that's positive right there. But you can go to grindselect.com for everything you need to know about the record label. They have a Bandcamp, of course, grindselect.bandcamp.com. Some of the Philly bands on Grind Select include, I mentioned the Pine Barrens, I mentioned Grocer, the band Sunstep, Kerry Charles, who's from New Jersey, has a new record out this year as well. That's a really good one. They're on Grind Select. Nina Keith, Sam Greens, and a whole lot of other awesome artists on this label. They've put out, I think, close to 70, maybe even 80 releases over their tenure as a small independent record label. And that ain't nothing. And sticking around for 10 years ain't nothing, especially in the music world where everything's up and down, everything's changing, and it's really, really hard to put out independent level music and like just keep the lights on. Like, I'm not even talking about like making salaries or, you know, buying cars or, you know, supplanting your income in any way. I'm just like, it's just hard to keep the lights on. And to do things for artists that make them, you know, want to come back to you and all that. So big congratulations to Jeremy and the whole team at Grind Select for 10 years. And I'm coming up on 10 years this year, too. So it's an interesting, I don't know, I've been thinking about 10 years a lot lately as sort of a benchmark, a milestone. So it was very, very cool to talk to Jeremy about that. What do they got now? Some of the latest stuff. The new Grocer record is going to come out in mid-April. There's a single out right now. But you can go to grindselect.com for all the information about that and all the other new stuff that they're putting out right now. Like I said, killer record label. And I had to be reminded of that several times over the last decade. Not because they weren't putting out great music, but because my attention span and memory is small. And I don't think that's a record label's responsibility to fix that. I think that's my responsibility. But yeah, great to talk to Jeremy. So let's get to it. My conversation with Jeremy Garber, co-founder, manager of Grind Select, an independent record label based here in Philadelphia. Let's talk here on 25 o'clock. No, I definitely agree with you that there it is this sort of like, it's this line to walk between like, I want people to be informed. I don't want people to miss stuff that we're doing, be it a podcast or band or a record label. But I know that like sometimes the common thought amongst many people is like, oh, we'll just always be up in their face. I'm like, no, that's fatiguing for you and for your audience.
Yeah, I think that I feel like I'm doing it pretty intentionally when I want to, you know, announce a record, obviously, or maybe if there's other singles. But I'm not trying to like bombard people all the time with every related, you know, announcement for a band, whether it's a tour or merch or, yeah, you know. I try to be careful, I guess, about what I'm, you know, putting out there. And just hope that people are finding out about bands that we work with from other ways also.
Yeah, yeah. A band gets written about, a band plays a show, exactly. Or plays a show with your friends or something like that. And yeah. Like that's, I mean, it does all kind of start at the musician-to-musician level sometimes. And, you know, sometimes it's like kind of a rough go to be like a band's band. Like I've been in that band where it's like you look out and it's just all other musicians who are into you. And you're just sure. Like, you think maybe regular people could like this too?
There are definitely a lot of artists, not to name drop any right off the bat, that are band's bands that we've worked with. Whether they're doing something a little more like technically proficient or for whatever reason, they're just resonating more with like other people like I'm impressed with the production, like I want to find out more about it, but then sometimes the regular people in certain cases it'll be a little bit harder to bring them along.
And I don't mind those bands. Like I like those bands because like if you're, and you don't have to be a musician, but anyone who's like immersed in the biz, if you hear a lot of stuff at some point, you hear a lot of the same stuff. So anytime you hear anything that jumps out a little bit, even if it's in like maybe a more aggressive or caustic or like atonal way, there's always part of me. I'm just like, oh, well, you got my attention.
Right.
Well, it's like, I don't even know if I like this.
Yeah, if it catches your attention, that's good. I mean, I've never, myself and I run the label with a couple of people, started the label with a couple of people. And the idea was the three of us pretty much agree on what we're putting out just from a, do we like this perspective?
Yeah, yeah.
Really no other consideration when we started. It was just like, is this cool? Do we all like it? That was it. Yeah.
Well, where'd you start? So you, I know you're not from Philly. You're from like Long Island, right?
From Long Island, born and raised in, I don't know if you're too familiar with Long Island.
Familiar enough. Okay. Which part are you from? North Shore, South Shore?
Well, I was born and raised in East Meadow, it's called, Nassau County. And then my parents moved to Syosset, which is near like Huntington, but North
like
Shore.
North of Farming, like, or no, it's like kind of north and a little west of, I'm trying to.
Yeah.
It's that middle part of Long Island where everything is 20 minutes from everything else.
And you said Farmingdale, though, you're somewhat familiar.
Yeah. And I know like Amityville and.
Cool.
Because I have friends who live out and around there.
Used to play there a lot with my high school band.
Yeah.
In Amityville.
Long Island, it always strikes me as like to be from Long Island, you either never go back or
you go back immediately and you never leave. I don't know too many people who are like half in, half out on Long Island.
That's true. definitely once I got out, never considered moving back. Although I'll say when I go back now, these days I appreciate it maybe a little bit more for what it is. I like living in Philadelphia a lot more.
Oh, yeah.
And I lived in Brooklyn for a bit. For various reasons, I'm glad not to be living there anymore.
Sure, sure. Yeah. I mean, it's fun to do the New York thing, and especially if you're at an age and you're involved in music, like there could be no better place at certain times to have been there. But it's a lot.
It's a lot, and then, you know, you hit your 30s and you're like, you know, this maybe, is a...
Maybe everything I do shouldn't be a struggle.
Exactly.
Maybe going to the grocery store and like... meeting up with friends one time shouldn't be this like massive thing, because like in New York, most of your day, if you like, there's the part of your day you're at work, and then there's that chunk of your day where you just spent trying to get to and from wherever it is you're going.
Yeah, and like I was just over being woken up by like horns, like people laying on their horns getting on the BQE.
Oh, you were whatever. By the BQE.
I was like right by the on ramp of the BQE. Actually, so after that, my partner and I moved up to the Hudson Valley, and we thought we would be there.
Which part?
Kingston, actually.
Okay, yeah.
And then for various reasons, like during the pandemic, well, everyone started moving up.
Well, yeah, everyone started going to the Hudson Valley, and you're like, we got to get out of here.
I mean, not exactly, but yeah, no.
They're all coming.
I read that, so Hudson was the number one zip code that people moved to, and Kingston was the second in the entire country.
Really?
During the pandemic.
Yeah. Wow.
Which is like, that's a pretty crazy statistic.
I mean, there's a lot of people in New York and like in New York City or like Jersey or like Jersey City or whatever. And yeah, like I thought about that too, being living in Philly, like during it. I've never thought of leaving until 2020, where I never would have entertained it. But like when all the cool things about being in a place are removed and all you're left with is like, well, we all live on top of each other and there's a lot of us. You just look around and you're just like, why the heck am I here?
Yeah.
And that's the first time I ever thought that. I've been here since like 03-04. It was the first time I was ever like, maybe we don't stay here.
Right.
Because it sucked. There were fireworks all the time and there were cop flyovers. My friends were getting, you know, maced and pepper sprayed protesting. Jeez. And it was bad. It was bad down here. And not as bad as it was in other, like it was obviously worse in other parts of the city, but like it was just, it just felt bad. Like I know that's such a lame like word, but you just
no. I totally
there was there was psychic agita going on.
Agita, love that word. Yeah, not to dwell on COVID, but the zip code I used to live in, I think, was like among the initial outbreak. So it was just like ambulance after ambulance.
Oh wow!
I mean, this I didn't mean for this to get so
no, but it's you know upsetting. It was a thing,
but yeah,
we were all there.
It wasn't that
long ago.
Yeah, and no one knew what was going on. Yeah. And I think also that was like, we decided to move before COVID, but it was very much like, get me out of here.
Yeah.
My association with Brooklyn is probably the end of being there of like, okay, this feels dangerous.
Yeah.
Like things are happening and I'm still having to move my car across the street.
Have to move across the street. They're still sweeping now.
Yeah, they actually were. I'm in Mount Airy now. So Northwest Philly. I'm happy to be there.
It's nice up there.
Yeah.
Quiet. Are you like kind of near like the Wissahickon side of it or?
Yeah.
That's beautiful.
So like basically if you go across Germantown Ave right near my block, you can get right into the Wiss that way.
Yeah. I mean, to go back to that time too, I mean, a lot of us, I mean, those of us who were inclined, I spent a lot of time in woods everywhere.
Of course.
In an hour radius.
Yeah.
I discovered all kinds of Pine Barrens trails. I discovered a lot of stuff up by Valley Forge. And Wissahickon was always like, I don't want to go far. So we just nip up there. We had our neighborhoods we liked to park in and just walk and hike, and I'd ride. I'd mountain bike up some of those trails. They're killer. I'm too old to do that now. I can't do that.
Well, that was the amazing thing of being in the Hudson Valley during COVID, because I bought a bike the first week and then the bike shop sold out of bikes.
Oh, yeah.
And I was like, I coincidentally like bought the last bike, I guess. Yeah. But then, it was up there riding like all the time.
Yeah. What else are you going to do?
Yeah.
Yeah, I did the same thing. And I practiced a lot of guitar. Like, I did a lot. Do you play? It's something I was curious about. I didn't know if you played or not.
Yeah, I play drums. That's pretty much been my only instrument for Since I was like 13.
Let's take it back. So you start playing drums when you're 13. Do you like music in the house? Are your family musically inclined, or are you the oddball?
Definitely the oddball in some ways. Well, I come from a family of entertainment, I'll say. My dad's a professional magician. Like, he's been doing that his whole life. Exclusively, like, that's his full-time occupation.
I suppose if you're good, there's like very few people who are good.
Yeah, I mean, he established a niche for himself, so there was like the magic stuff going on, and my mom was into a lot of like Broadway soundtracks and stuff, and my sister too, by way I guess of my mom. I mean, I have memories of like being young, my dad actually showing me like Pink Floyd or like Springsteen or, you know, various.
Was he like, not to dwell on your father, but like, was he like an old school magician? Was he a little more of like those like kind of like cooler close up guys, or?
Yeah. So kind of a mix, but what he ended up being, I guess, proficient in was, well, he does card magic, but he does a lot of like kids parties. Mm-hmm. So it was more of that comedy magic for kids, but I've seen him do like adult parties too. And he'll do like walk around and things like that. So he's very like...
You do some crowd work.
He's done it all, but he's known mostly as a kids magician.
Yeah. I mean, well, that's kind of your bread and butter, it can be. Especially on Long Island, there's a lot of bar and bat mitzvahs, a lot of christenings, a lot of first communions to show up at. At least he didn't have to like be a clown. Like,
right. Yeah, totally. Yeah. He would have clowns traveling with him sometimes for the parties, but...
Y'all can just carpool.
Yeah. It was like that. So that was like normal growing up.
Those were
like
his buds?
Yeah.
You just come home and there's your dad and there's some clown just in the kitchen drinking a cup of coffee.
Basically. And he still is part of magic clubs with like a lot of zany people who are very interesting people. Yeah.
But it's still, it's a craft. Like it's... You learn that sleight of hand. You learn those tricks. Like, he practiced those tricks over and over and over again to make them look the way that they look.
And it's incredible to me. And it always, like, more so recently, that it worked out for him. Like, it just, he never considered doing anything else, and it just worked out. And I think
when you
really
decide that you're going to start a record label in your early 20s, he's just like, nah, he's like, still not the weirdest thing I've heard of.
Oh, yeah, no, I wasn't worried about being judged for that. I was working for an artist management company before that. I went to school up in Syracuse, New York.
I'm from Rochester, so.
Oh, no way.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So for like a music industry type program. So I knew I wanted to be involved in music, but to take it back a little more.
You're playing drums.
I basically was taking lessons, but like quickly got into heavier and crazier music. And I was like, you know, I just want to play in a band and like kind of figure things out on my own. So I met through a performing arts sleepaway camp I went to, my friend Corey Regensburg, who is Moonbounce, who was formerly in Philly. I don't know if that name rings a bell at all.
I know he's part of the label.
Yeah. So we had started a band in high school together, this kind of like zany grindcore-esque band called A Dire Symphony, and played all over Long Island. So I've known him forever. And that was very much like my bread and butter growing up, was like that scene of
like grindcore and just like real heavy, loud,
like
music.
Interesting.
We're wearing a
Madball
sweatshirt right now. So
yeah.
Like,
well, that this is my default uniform because I have a 8-month old now, and it's just like he spits up on it every day, and I put it back on. I wash it and put it back on, and that it just the cycle continues. But no disrespect to Madball. Still,
I'm pretty sure those guys in Madball have also been spit up upon.
Oh yeah,
A lot of those guys are dads too. So.
Yeah, but I was definitely drawn to, and Corey too, like the more like crazy technical side of things, like bands that we like would play like minute long songs and change like do a million different
like Lightning Bolt.
Yeah,
and stuff
exactly.
Like that. Yeah.
Huge fan of Lightning Bolt. I mean, there were a lot of Long Island-based bands that no longer exist, but like we played with this band like Dr. Acula a lot, who are still doing their thing.
Dr. Acula. I like that. Yeah.
And they had a lot of samples, so we would do like samples.
Oh,
also.
Weird. Yeah.
That lasted through high school. Then I was like, hey, I should, or not should, but like I don't know of anything else I'm interested in, but to be a part of, because we would book our own shows too.
Yeah.
And I was like, I want to be a part of this in some other way. So I went to this program in Syracuse. It was the first year they were doing this. program.
I discovered that today when I was poking around the music program, the music business program at Syracuse. Because Syracuse, I mean, now people know it more as it's a medical school. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of things, but it basically takes up the entire city.
Yes.
My mom got her master's there in social work. My grandmother lived there. So like I know... Like I knew Syracuse up to a point, and I drive through it every time I go home.
Yeah.
But it is an interesting kind of like almost like nothing little city in the middle, like in the very end of the Rust Belt. Like that's Syracuse.
Yeah.
No offense to anyone in Syracuse.
No, I mean, and I.
It's a company town.
For sure. I didn't know much about it at all when I was going up there, other than I got into this program and like it sounds really cool and I don't.
And it was the first year. It was the first year of this music business track, which was got to be, in retrospect, if you like, that's like possibly the worst time to get involved in a program. We don't know what this is. Give us some money.
Oh yeah, we were there were 15 of us. We were very much guinea pigs in a very large school. The curriculum was not developed yet at all, so I was taking more like. Well, we all were like theory classes, and like there were definitely like performance-based classes within the scope of this. It's completely different now, I'll just say. But you know, we would attend like symphony, you know, concerts, and like it was more of like it was based in the music school in Syracuse. Yeah. Now it's in the communication school.
Maybe slightly more appropriate place for it to be.
But I really value the I guess the experience being a guinea pig. Because I think much like the industry is in general and how you have to be very proactive and constantly like looking for new ways to do things, it kind of kept us on our feet.
And to be steeped in a wide array of experiences that weren't just immediately because now it's like if you think of like the Full Sail model or something like that, which is more of recording tech, but still, I'm sure there's a music business. Of course, there's a music business wing of Full Sail.
I'm sure,
If they can charge money for it, they have figured out how to charge money for it.
Oh, yeah.
But that stuff is probably all very much like maybe in the rock or hip hop world as well. Whereas in you said you're going to orchestra concerts and you're getting taught by people who are largely like classic music pedagogy type professors.
Yeah, there was that. And then they would, so there was like, classes, obviously the first time they've ever done these classes, like record label 101 or like publishing 101 or like, you know.
Did you find it useful at the time? Because you went at a time where everything was such flux become even more in flux.
Well,
later.
What's insane is thinking I went to school when streaming wasn't even the business model yet. I mean,
it was still downloads.
Yeah, it was starting to get there. I found it helpful to like see, for example, like what certain contracts would look like. I mean, this makes me sound really nerdy, but I do like that.
No, it's just interesting stuff.
Like historically, you know, in the days of like Tin Pan Alley, but they kept these clauses in and they're still in like a breakage with
breakage. Yes. Like, I bring that up all the time. It's like, you know, the idea that the record label still recoups X amount of money off the fact that your vinyl can break.
Right.
Now that's back now. So it has more relevance than it. But 20 years ago, nobody was pressing vinyl.
Right. Or like what a mechanical royalty is and how that even applies to streams, which we weren't even talking about.
No, and it kind of doesn't.
It kind of doesn't.
They had to come up with a new thing.
But the most valuable thing that came out of that whole experience was industry people coming to speak with us and making connections and having internships through the program. That even though if I hated the internships, which there were a couple, which I did not, just didn't vibe with, the experience was still valuable to know what I didn't want to do or know what rubbed me the wrong way or things I would do differently. So I like ended up interning for a couple of major labels like Island Def Jam and Republic, and then in Radio Promo at Island Def Jam.
Oh God!
Where they
talk about a time and a place to do that.
It really was
Radio Promo. So Island Def Jam too, like probably one of the labels still consistently making money up to that point. But radio at that time, like what
weird.
Even was it? Because you still had these people holding on to this old model.
Yes.
There was no new model because it was still being written. You guys were like to liken this almost to post-war Europe or something like that without like, you know, the devastation.
Sure.
But like the old way is dead.
Yes.
The new way hasn't been written yet. And you are living in this to take a quote from Thomas Pynchon, like you're living in the wasteland.
Totally.
Like that's what T.S. Eliot was writing about right there.
You're totally right.
You probably never thought, you probably thought about it like that. When you
exactly like that.
Ah, oh, yes, the wasteland. That is where we are. This ungridded.
Yes, it was very much like that, where you see how things are being done for all these years. You know, there's still like a Mariah Carey record at radio that's like killing it, obviously, because shout out Mariah Carey. You know, I think Fall Out Boy was on the label at that time. I remember running tickets to like stations and, you know, Pale is dead, right? But I'm passing.
Tickets are tickets. It's trade.
Tickets,
yeah. It's not cash.
You're right.
It's not cash, blow, or sex workers. So,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
It's better. We've come a long way.
Right. But I do remember, so there was a staff meeting, and Jermaine Dupri was running Island Def Jam at the time, or just Def Jam, probably. I don't.
Jermaine Dupri, the mastermind behind Criss Cross. Yeah. There's your Philly tie.
Yeah, okay, bring
that
back.
They recorded it at Studio 4 with the Butcher, with the Niccolos. So,
okay.
Yeah.
The first artist comes into the, this must have been 2011, and he brings in an artist they just signed from YouTube. And this was the early days of doing that. Like, yeah. Justin Bieber was recently discovered from YouTube, and they're just hoping for, you know, this is our second.
That's how it goes. If you see the guy, your analog, the other label,
yeah,
doing something, you have to go. They're like, well, they're making money with this weirdo who points a camera at himself in front of his computer. But like, that was the beginning of that. Yeah. Like, yeah. 2011, 2012. And you would have these breakout artists that were bringing in huge numbers digitally, and like a huge demand if you could get them into a studio to make a single. But like, they couldn't play. Like, they couldn't go in front of people. Yet they were still sent out in front of people.
I mean, I will say there was this staff meeting where it was pretty much everyone from the company crammed into the conference room. And
that's always good. You always feel like you're going to get fired.
I feel terrible that I don't remember this artist's name. But she really did have a great voice. She came in with her mom, sang to the conference room. And they were making a big deal about signing her from YouTube. And I think they dropped her quickly after her first single came out.
Yeah.
And I realized,
you didn't know what to do with it.
Yeah. And I was, that really was disheartening. The whole thing was disheartening to me. The major label thing. I was like, this, I knew this wasn't for me based on my background, but like, it's interesting to see it from the inside and see. But I did. I met my friend Dan Golden from Exploding and Sound Records, who was there and went on to start an incredible label. I don't know if you're familiar with them.
No, I'm not.
Brooklyn based and / Boston a little bit based label. But I met him under the same circumstances, and we both kind of went off into this, you know, more independent direction.
Yeah.
I ended up also interning for Epitaph in LA, and a different world, and
absolutely
was much happier with what I found there. Also.
Yeah. And Epitaph still, because I know this when I've talked to like Missy from Mannequin Pussy, and Epitaph still seems very much to run in the way that it did 20, 30 years ago.
Totally.
I mean, but they're the same in all the right, from what I gather from just seeing, they're the same in all the right ways, mm-hmm. and then they have changed in all the ways that have mattered.
I mean, they've definitely adapted with the times. A lot of the artists that maybe diehard fans of like the Epitaph catalog, of like the back catalog, aren't into, but they're doing that to support the stuff that doesn't make as much money.
Well, they were always fun. They would just put out weird stuff. Like, there's Tom Waits records that came out on Epitaph.
Yep.
Like, it's, that to me is as much cred as your Bad Religions and your Pennywise and your and Rancid and all that, which is all this, I came up with all that stuff.
Right.
And the idea that like Bad Religion, like the flagship band of that label, the band that label was created for, by, and mm-hmm. for, jumped ship periodically because they knew that like, well, if we want to kick our band to the next level, we need distribution. And we can't do that on our own. And I credit them for that, for Bad Religion and Epitaph for having that, and for Epitaph for keeping their points on the back end from Stranger Than Fiction mm-hmm. and Great Race. Like, and also, they're the reason why guys like you and me who grew up in the suburbs know who the hell Bad Religion are.
Totally. I mean, they're a legendary company. They have the most integrity of a lot of record labels. I felt when I was there that everyone really was interested in doing their job to the best of their ability. Like, no one was phoning in. Maybe there's some artists like people, you know, preferred over others, but no one was really phoning it in, I'll say.
Yeah.
And it felt like obviously a smaller operation, but
felt like a little family.
Yeah, it felt more like a family. The office was also in a cool spot in Silver Lake.
Well, hey, doesn't hurt.
Yeah.
No, but it is cool to like to work in those situations with other like-minded music people. Like, I'm not talking about artists, but like, you know, label people, people who care enough about it to get involved in the nuts and bolts, which is can be very mundane and just crazy.
Yeah.
To want to do it because you're just like, I believe in this label. Like, there's a time, and I think we're largely gone from that now, or maybe that's just me being old, but if you saw a record label on something, you looked at the record label first before you looked at the band.
Absolutely.
Like, who's this band? I don't know, but they're on Epitaph, they're on Touch and Go, they're on Merge, you know, they're on Matador. Right.
I grew up the same way in that when I was buying CDs at the time, or tapes a little bit, but mostly CDs.
Yeah.
Reading liner notes, looking at who bands thanked.
Producers.
Yeah, how you found other musicians, and it didn't feel, you weren't so bombarded, like in Spotify, you open it up and you're just like, there's too many bands.
There's actually a drop down on there where you can see credits. Like, they finally have done it. I discovered it this morning.
Yeah.
When I was looking through one of your I was looking at Dominic Sen's stuff.
Okay, cool.
And I clicked on I did it by accident. Like, I clicked on it by mistake, being like, oh no, I don't want to click that. And then I looked at the bottom and I go, is that production credit?
Yeah.
And I was just like, how about that?
That's great that they have that. Hopefully labels easily, you can search label in a roundabout way. I hope they make that more streamlined soon.
I don't think it's in their interest to make it more
streamlined. Yeah, we can only hope, but yeah, so I can totally relate to what you're saying. And so labels have always meant a lot to me in general. And so I ended up going more into management, artist management though, working with, I was doing like day-to-day management travel stuff for like Mastercraft and Death From Above 1979, and like some DJs who were pretty big at the time, like Wolfgang Gartner, Felix Kartal. This was in LA, so I moved to LA after school. I learned a lot doing that, and then I brought Corey on board to the management company, and we were basically getting ready to release his EP, the first thing we ever put out, Dress Rehearsal, through an affiliated label for that from that company, and they kept dragging kind of their feet, and there was no real, like, no one to talk to, and I'm like, we should just be doing this ourselves. I don't know what that means at that point. I was just like, do we just self-release it? And I'm like, no, we need a name to put on it that's just makes us not look like,
yeah, it doesn't, yeah, yeah, no, it's
we're just
true.
Self-releasing it.
But that's, I mean, but that's a tale as old as time right there, like going back to like the SST days or something like that. That's Greg Ginn in his basement turning his mail order transistor company, which I guess he already has a business license for. It's just like, well, it's a record label now.
Right, right.
Yeah. Or Discord, or like any of these little labels are just like, well, we'll start by putting ourselves or and like, our friends.
Yeah, our friends. Yeah. That's always like a big influence to us early on. Also was 31G from San Diego, Justin Pearson from like The Locust and a million other bands.
Yeah.
I remember
The Locust. Yeah.
Yeah. So
I was writing for zines at this time.
Cool.
So like, it's you were like just coming up as like a young, just out of college. I've been out of college longer, but I was writing for like these West Coast zines.
Nice.
And like The Locust was part of that. And like, even before that, like Gang Gang Dance and Gossip and like this like kind of like early aughts Pitchfork era bands, and like writing about Grizzly Bear and St. Vincent and all that. Yeah.
Yeah. And weirdly enough, The Locust ended up on Anti for a record.
Another fantastic record label.
So we formed the label and put out the
EP. You put
EP.
Out Corey's thing.
We were introduced to, for publicity, to Jesse Frick from Father Daughter, who at the time was doing more outside PR, and she really, I just want to give her a shout out for like helping us like establish the label. I mean, it did better than we thought. One of the lead single, Shake, at the time, I mean, you judge stuff more by downloads than streams back then.
Yeah.
It felt like it did well. Like Vice wrote about it. Like it did better than we expected. Yeah. I'll say
better than like a couple guys being like, well, I guess we'll just do this on our own and fall flat on our faces and then go get real jobs.
Totally. After that, even I don't think I was under the impression we'd started a record label. I was like, this was a thing we did for your music only.
Yeah.
So the next thing we put out was another EP for him, which we tried. This is where we started kind of getting weird with it, and where kind of like the genesis of the label, I feel like, really like solidified. We did these scratch off lotto tickets where basically you could scratch off and you would always be a winner, but you would win different things.
Yeah.
It was just a fun like project, like art project essentially. Yeah. But
physical and tangible too, which at the time like everyone was getting away from. But you still had download carts, because I remember as a band still selling download carts or handing out download carts to people, because people were like, how can I find your music? And it wasn't just like go to the one or two places that everybody goes for that.
Yep.
It was just like, this was still in the day of like The Orchard and CD Baby and various other Reverb Nation, not Reverb.
Yeah,
I spend significantly more time on Reverb, just looking at things that I thankfully don't buy in the middle of the night. But there were all these different places, like SoundCloud.
SoundCloud was huge then. Yeah,
we think of SoundCloud now as an industry tool, as a way to send like lossless, good quality audio between labels and press and all that. But at the time, like, they were really trying to be like a
totally. I mean, there was a lot of traffic on SoundCloud. Mm-hmm. You just uploaded your
there still is now for hip hop. Like, it's still kind of the main. I get reminded about that every once in a while, because I'm just like, SoundCloud, and I'm like, oh, there's still a little thriving thing going on here.
They're still doing their thing. I mean, I'm happy to still have them around. But yeah, the early days, there were SoundCloud late. I mean, there still are, but
yeah, SoundCloud labels
with electronic music a lot of times. Mm-hmm.
It was the easiest way to do it, because those guys, they don't have to. You don't have to get a band together and go into a studio. Those guys are doing it off laptops, off their computers, in their bedrooms and basements, and you could just instantly put your stuff up there.
And there was a community there, and those were fun days.
Yeah, MP3 blogs, which was like could take a band national faster than any record
like
label.
Hype Machine, if you had enough blogs, Machine, it was a big deal. That ended up happening with this release, in that like a lot of people from France were very interested. The UK, like left field electronic music fans. But we brought our friend in, and who's been running the label predominantly with me today, Kyle Stetz.
Yeah.
Also went to UArts, and he is a developer and put together the landing page for this Redeem site for the lotto ticket.
Yeah.
And then he's like, I want to kind of work. I like, doing more interactive web work. Maybe we can integrate that into what you're doing. And that's kind of, we ran with that for a while. We don't do that as much anymore, but we would do basically interactive websites paired with releases for
You were doing that early on.
Yeah.
At a time when I don't know if that was early or late for that, but it was just, you didn't see that much in DIY music.
I mean, it was definitely more like we had fun doing it, and I'm really proud of all that stuff. I think Kyle's really proud of all that stuff, but it really, like, for 50 or 100 people to check it out. The one that went crazy viral was Type Drummer, which at the time was on like the front page of Reddit multiple times and drove a lot of traffic to the label.
Yeah.
But a vast majority of them just like went in a small circle of people, played a game once, or like played around with something else. But it just wasn't. We couldn't justify the amount of work, I guess, that went into it to what we were seeing.
It is very interesting, though. And it does speak to that idea of like a DIY record label, smaller record label, being like, well, look, we can't compete with the rest of them at their own game. Like, we'll always come up short.
Yeah.
Like, not even short. Like, we can't even go to the table. It comes back to that older, like, DIY hardcore punk spirit. I don't talk about just like music style, but just like that community idea. We're just like, well, then we're just going to do our own weird, arty thing.
Exactly. And we never after Moonbounce's first two releases, I was introduced to All Boy All Girl, who were a 7-piece orchestral pop.
There were so many people in that band.
It couldn't have been a different type of artist than what Corey was doing. So then the label truly became like, whatever we want to put out, we'll put out. Doesn't matter, genre or format or any type of, it's just, we wanted it to resemble, Grind Select was the term created by Corey and I for putting money in a vending machine and hitting the buttons randomly and then having to
deal with whatever comes out.
Yeah. So if you wanted the Cheetos, you'd get the certs or whatever. But I don't know why I just name drop certs. Like, that's a popular
I haven't thought about the word certs, but when you said certs, immediately I got it in my head.
Is it like a lifesaver?
It's a breath mint.
Okay. It's a breath mint.
Yeah.
Right.
It doesn't have a hole. It's almost like a Rolaid, but But it's not certs are classy.
I'm gonna stop by Wawa on the way back and just see if I can
you still get certs?
I don't know, but
the little gold pack.
trying to bring back certs in a real way. That's why I'm on the podcast today.
We're not going for a company with money or cachet. No.
No, not at all. Who? Someone must own them, though, like Wrigley or...
Yeah, yeah. Procter & Gamble.
On a tangent about snacks now.
But you sign All Boy, All Girl, which is... Nick and Danielle, who would later go on to become Grocer, but at the time it's a 7-piece band. It has almost nothing to do with everything you'd put out before.
Nothing, absolutely. Nothing. I had no idea what I was doing, and I was signing everyone to management at the same time back then.
So label and management.
Yes. So I was booking their shows in New York. I was a sounding board for everything related to their career at that point, which was a lot with that many people, especially.
Oh yeah, and they like. If I recall correctly, like they tried to keep it like fairly democratic, like to the point where everyone could have a say. And I remember when Nick told me that, I thought to myself, I'm like, yeah, the Grateful Dead did that too. And it was very strange.
And none of their albums or EPs or whatever, they sound kind of completely different because they kept morphing as a band. Yeah. I think where they're at with Grocer right now is very, like they hit their stride with, I mean, maybe... the songwriting is great, but I'm saying it's not as maybe technically, like the instrumentation isn't as crazy as All Boy, All Girl.
No, because they went from a 7-piece band to a 4 and now they're 3.
Yeah.
And at the time, like in Grocer, like that was Danielle's first run at being a bass player.
Yes.
Like that was, I remember talking to her about that and her being like, she's like, I just try and stand up there and make it look like I know what I'm doing. It's been fun watching Nick become more of a mad scientist as he gets older. And it's been fun watching Danielle become more and more comfortable. She was always comfortable on stage as a singer, but to mm-hmm. become comfortable on stage now as an instrumentalist as well, and being able to hold her own. I don't know if I've ever told her that in person. Well, I hope she hears this.
Danielle, when you listen to this, make sure you think.
Don't cry.
No.
Nick also don't cry.
Yeah. No, I mean... I agree that I obviously thought of Danielle as a singer more, but now it's like, oh yeah, she used to sing more. Like she doesn't sing on all those tracks, but
She's a great player though.
Great player.
And really did master that band, especially when they went like the earlier days of Grocer when there were 4 of them. Like they really were kind of I always said it's like the Pixies. I said in form only. I said nothing really sonically to do with the band like the Pixies, but like the form of it, like the quiet loud, very arty, very strange, as influenced by, you know, film and like visual art as they would be by music. And to me, I think that to me, that's some of the most exciting, call it post-punk or whatever, music, is that it's as informed by other aspects of art.
Yes. And I think their album, which is coming, I'm going to plug it right now.
Absolutely.
April 19th, the new one called Bless Me is... I think their most like cohesive record. They wrote a lot more as a group on this one, and it probably has some of their like heavier moments, but it definitely feels like a band X amount of albums in. Yeah. It's like more mature.
They never really stopped touring. I mean, they stopped touring when everyone else did, but then they were still doing stuff. They were like playing shows like in that abandoned lot next to their house and stuff like that.
Yeah,
like, they were just figuring stuff out because. I mean, I don't know Corey that well, Corey from Grocer, but I know Nick and Danielle a little bit over many years. They're artists, like, and they're not. I mean, they're musicians, but they're artists. They're always going to make an artful. They're going to express themselves artfully, no matter what it would be.
Yeah,
Nick makes furniture, for God's sake.
They're just creative people. That's their brain works in a certain way.
Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. Very talented, and I'm really excited for people to hear the new record. And they're playing Johnny Brenda's on the 25th for an album release, which should be fun.
In March or?
April 25th.
April. Yeah. Okay, good. Good, I'm not going to miss it.
Cool.
Once you guys had kind of broken open the dam of being like, okay, well, then we're going to start reaching out. We're going to start including things that maybe we're not immediately friends with. Like, because like Pine Barrens are part of this. Or later you get someone like Dominic Sen, which.
Yes.
It's just like, at that point, you're like, when you said before, it's like, the core of the label is the 3 of you just being like, I don't know, do we all like it? If the answer is yes and we want to put our weight behind it, then let's do it.
Yeah, and a lot of that is also like, you know, listening to a recording is one thing, but seeing someone or a group of people and saying, like, do they have like some charisma, or is what they're doing like coming through in a way that's really moving us? There's so many people, especially in modern recording, like that have mastered a sound or make the most pristine sounding, you know, record is what I'm trying to say. I don't know. I think we all try to find individuals or, you know, groups that can like really embody that on stage, yeah, and keep writing interesting songs and maybe surprise us and not, you know, make the same record over again. Yeah. I don't know.
Pine Barrens are an excellent example. Oh, yeah. Like I remember first being introduced to them because Kyle from Headroom said, like, this is my brother's band. And I listened. And I was like, oh, these guys are good. And then, like, to hear the records that would come out subsequently from Pine Barrens, I think even, like, that jump into, like, that second or third record, I was like, oh, man. I was like, they're doing it.
I'm so impressed with them as a band. I mean, I have a bunch of favorite Philly bands, but I'm glad that a few of them are on the label.
Yeah.
Like, Pine Barrens, they did this I Love Fish project. A Fishman's cover album. I didn't know who Fishman's were, but during the pandemic,
was it a band or is it a?
So from Japan, they're this like cult classic.
Oh, interesting.
Band. They're like a major label band over there. The singer tragically died at a young age.
Are they called Fishman?
Fishman's. Yeah. They have one song called Long Season that I think is 32 minutes long. And it's like, you know, rateyourmusic.com. I think it's one of the highest rated on the entire site.
Wow.
It's
for 32 minutes.
That's impressive. 32 minutes, yeah. So during the pandemic, you know, we're all inside going crazy. And Casey, the singer, sends me a message, like, just geeking out about Fishman's. And, I mean, it really captured me from his enthusiasm, but also just from, like, diving into the discography where they felt like kindred spirits, even though Pine Barrens had not gone maybe the more electronic route as much yet. But then they're like, oh, we're going to do this entire cover album and we are going to translate everything to English. And we had to get that approved by like the estate of the singer in Japan.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. Oh, so as a label, that's something you had to get involved in to figure out how to do that.
Well, that, yeah. And also Pine Barrens too, because we want to obviously make it a personal outreach from like the band having, you know, doing this project. But yeah, we had to deal with a couple of publishers as well just to make sure we were kosher and putting it out. It was only digital, but they did a CD release in Japan, this other label in Japan. But they covered that song, Long Season.
The 32-minute
32
one.
Minutes. And it's, no, I don't think anyone's ever done that before.
That's something.
So that, when they did that project, I was like, okay, this band like has turned a corner. And I'm so excited. Like, we've been putting out singles pretty much since then, but their next project will come to fruition this year.
Oh, good.
There's a full album.
Yeah. I'm always interested to see what those guys are up to. I don't know if I've ever met any of them, but, like, I've always been into the music. I always thought it was very cool.
Yeah. They're just, like, every time I hear what they're working on, it surprises me in the best way possible.
Yeah. But at this point in the game, like, you weren't managing every band that came through the label anymore, because Pine Barrens, Marley was managing them at some point.
That is correct. Yeah. Early on, she was working with the Districts.
Yep.
Too.
Them, Dove and Wolf, Dirty Dollhouse too, I think. No, that was Karen Lederach. Mixing up all the powerful, amazing women that I know in the Philadelphia world. That was an interesting time in Philadelphia music as well, like kind of the rise of the Districts. Pine Barren, Hop Along was like cresting up. Bands are getting signed to, like, literally getting signed to J-Tree, getting signed to Saddle Creek, you know, labels that meant a ton to us when we were younger.
So that was a major like step into like Philadelphia music world for us. I feel like that.
Were you putting out like a lot of New York bands? Because you had just come back from New York.
New York still, I mean, we still put out a good amount of New York based bands, but yeah, at the time, like, this band has been broken up for a while, but they really were so important to the early days of the label, Music Room. A member lives in Philly now, Matt Coppola. He played drums for this band, Music Room. And initially they were kind of getting scouted by other labels. And it's funny how it panned out where, or it's not, maybe not funny for them. But
maybe it's funny now.
It's like, you know, there's be like A&R scouts coming out to their shows and like just kind of like not giving them an answer either way, and just let's see what happens in 2 months, 3 months, 4 months. I'm like, you've been working on this music for years, like, I'm not trying to push you in a direction, but we can put this out in four months.
Yeah, we can do this now.
Yeah. And that's another one that I think stands the test of time, called Pearly Whites by this band Music Room. I think if I was to like look at our catalog, which has, I think, 70 releases, including singles.
Wow. It's a lot.
Yeah. I mean, singles might not count. But
no, but it's like that's 70 releases. And you've been doing it for, you said this year's 10 years, right?
10 years.
You started the same year that I started this show.
There you go.
We were both think you are about 10 years younger than I am, too.
Okay.
I'm 43.
Yeah, 34.
Yeah, yeah. I came at it kind of from the come down from like being in a touring band and being like, I don't want to, and you guys were coming up being like, oh, we're going to get really involved. And I was changing the way I was involved with the community, and you guys were ramping up into how you were going to be involved. It's just interesting how everyone sort of passes each other, and like 10 years may seem like a lot, or it may not seem like much of anything at all. Like really, if you think about it, I've been thinking about the number 10 a lot.
I was going to say, like, how do you feel now that you're almost at the 10-year mark?
It'll be 10 in the fall.
How do you feel 10 years in? Like, do you feel this, I don't even want to say happy with things or how we're going, but like, do you feel like
you're
done? Still having fun with it? Are you
Yeah.
Okay, good.
If I wasn't having fun with it, I wouldn't do it anymore.
Yeah.
I mean, that's why I left bands in 2013, because I wasn't having fun. I wasn't having fun with all the bullshit that went around with being in a band. I love playing.
Sure, sure.
But when I got in, when I started doing the podcast, it was, how do I continue to engage in a community that I have been a part of in one way? And at first, to me, it was just like a placeholder. It was just like, well, I still want to hang out with friends. I was at an age where you can very easily disappear. In your mid-30s, you can very easily disappear. Mm-hmm. And maybe you've thought about this too, with becoming a father and all that.
Yeah.
You worry about, like, I have to keep a foot in this or else I'll disappear, because we know the attention span is like that. But what started as that, I learned, and I'm sure you learned this with a record label too, is that, like, now you have something to offer. When you're in a band, you just want. You're a little want machine. And that's fine. But that's how it works. Like... And when you have a record label or an outlet, now when I go to people, it's like, hey, come be on my show, because I need someone to be on my show.
Right.
But also you're just like, come be on my show and talk about what you do. And we'll put this out to maybe 50, 100 people more than we were going to before. Just like a small record label.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we'll sell 200 more copies of your record than you would have sold playing bars. And it starts like that.
I think it's really important what you're doing, first of all.
I also think it's really important what you guys are doing too.
Because I think of the releases we put out, I still think of it as like, not even my legacy, just a legacy of music. I mean, when we're all gone, like I hope that this stuff will live on and like mean something to someone.
Well, it's to have like sort of an organized body of work. It's odd. I think you and I come at this in the same way, and we probably think about this in the same way. When I say body of work, I don't mean mine. I mean, even though I was part of it.
Totally.
Because, like, it's not yours. Like, these bands made these records. They went off and recorded. They made all the artistic decisions. You guys aren't a label that, like, tells bands what to do.
How do you know? No.
If so, keep doing it, because these bands are doing it.
But, we do not.
No, you take bands. Kind of the Albini approach, which is just, like, you are what you are, and all we're going to do is just help elevate what you are.
Yep.
And that's how I am with this show, too. It's like, so when I think of body of work, it's weird to include myself in that, because I'm just like, but the artist came and talked about being an artist, but it's like, but I shaped it and I gave it an outlet, and I have to take credit for that. I have to accept that I had something to do with that, because it's very easy to just be like, oh, shucks, you know?
No, absolutely. I mean, these are like moments in time that are really special, and people go through their lives, and to look back at, I mean, I'm sure you've had people on the podcast many times throughout the years, and then it's just like, it's important to have time capsules, I believe.
And it's important, and like when I'll have people over and they play, like they sit right where you're sitting and they just play. And I'm like, that's something to me, like just this small little performance right there. And it's usually, it's 99 times out of 100, it's just me and them.
Right, right.
Every once in a while, my wife will come down and sit on the stairs to watch somebody play.
Nice.
But it's, or she'll just be upstairs and she'll hear them. So technically two people, but it's interesting to capture these moments in time and then just to have them live somewhere. To me, I think sometimes the work, and I'm sure you think this too as a record label, is keeping the archive.
Yes.
The archive is important.
Yep.
I always think about getting this stuff transcribed and all that. I've messed around with like AI, you know, transcription. It's about the only thing I could find a use for AI.
Yeah.
And it doesn't do a great job. Well, it didn't do a great job 5 years ago. Who knows if it does a better job now, but...
It might be worth looking into.
Yeah.
I am a new father, you know, and I... Not that I'm like... I hope my son thinks of like, this is cool what I'm doing. It's just like, I think that this is something I can like show of myself, of being involved with these projects. That's like an unspoken thing. Like you can look into, you can listen to any of these records, and I've put a lot of myself into them, and not in the way of like making them, but in the way of like, I've been involved. Like we all work on like a Slack group mostly. So we're like in the trenches, just like hashing out every small detail and like, you know, long conversations with artists. I don't want to say therapy sessions, but sometimes.
No, but it is.
It turns into that.
No, it is. I mean, producers, label people, like, because they're putting out like the kind of artists that you deal with, the kind of artists that I have on this show, like that's them. They're putting themselves out.
Yeah.
It's not a contrived thing. It's not a character. That's them.
Yeah. And
so
really,
when you're dealing
really
with someone,
personal.
Yeah, when you're dealing with that personal nature of someone, it is going to delve into like sort of that stereotypical therapy session.
I really want everything we put out to reach some type of audience, you know, and it's hard to like, even if I've done everything I could do, it's hard to be like, hey, like, I thought this was going to work out 30% better for, you know, in some way. So I don't know. But I keep doing it because I don't know what I would do if I would stop. Like,
no, I'm the same way. It's a weird answer. But like, because people said like, oh, well, how many more are you going to do? I'm like, I don't know. I'm going to do this until it doesn't make sense to do it anymore.
Right, right.
I couldn't tell you the confluence of events that would make that. It's not, because you know this too from being a record label. It's like you can look at the numbers, and it's important. There needs to be some metric of whether or not you're even remotely hitting the things that you want.
Yes.
There's nothing in the numbers that would ever make me stop.
Right.
That's not going to be what makes me stop.
Yeah, I think... consistency and just like I believe this, and I tell myself this probably once a week, but just like like keeping your head down and like doing like the work, but also just like those small like tasks that, I mean, running a label is so much like sitting in front of a computer and just like
sending and answering emails, hashing
out insignificant details,
but they're not though, because you understand enough that you're just like, we are sweating this small thing because when we get it right,
yes,
it could be the difference between, and we're not talking about money, which it could be the difference between whether or not this resonates or whether or not it doesn't.
Totally. I just hope that the younger generation, now here is where I start to sound like an old man, but cares about record labels, like you were talking a little bit before, you know, when we were younger and looking at labels in a light where we're like almost enamored with the labels as we were the artists that they represent. It's not that I expect so much. I just don't want it to go away completely.
No, me neither. Me neither. It's good to have like curation measures in place. And a record label is that. Even if it's three guys who know each other being like, we think this is cool. Yeah. And not like, we think this is cool, and so thereby what we don't think anything else is cool. We're just like, no, this is just things that we think are cool.
Totally. Like, and it's almost ironic. We've never released like a... hardcore record or like something in that realm,
even though you're all like, you all
right,
love that music.
We'll talk about mostly that music between the three of us, and then we work with like Dominic Sun, who's a pop artist. We love that stuff a lot too, clearly, but it's just a little funny sometimes when I think about it.
But it makes sense too, because you just like, you know what that is, though. You know what kind of music that's going to be. And it's fun to... I mean, same thing when I have artists on. I'm just like, I don't even... Like I'm not the biggest hip-hop aficionado. Like, I bring in, like, a hip-hop or, like, a more modern R&B singer or artist. I'm always just like, this is cool. Like, I don't know as much about this. Or jazz. Like, I like some jazz, but... it's one of the last genres of music I can still approach like a normal, like a regular person, and just be like, I can just get floored by stuff. Electronic music is a lot of that for me too. Like, I don't truly know how it gets made.
Right.
I mean, I understand what the programs are and all that, but I don't understand how that works.
Yeah, I didn't expect myself, just even at a younger age, that I would get into electronic music the way I did.
Yeah.
And like, it wasn't only that Corey was making, it was the stuff he was showing me at the time that he was inspired by, which sounded so emotional and human despite being made. Like, you know, like Telephone Tel Aviv or like Boards of Canada.
Oh, yeah,
stuff like that.
Even
I was
like
really
Burial
into.
And stuff like that.
Oh, Burial was huge.
Like those
for
first
me,
couple
yeah.
Burial records, I was like, it sounds like you pulled them out of an oil soaked puddle at night.
Oh,
like,
my God. It's, yeah, it's so much.
And then I learned later that it's because all his shit was broken. Like,
wait,
none
really?
Of it, none of it worked. He was
I didn't know this.
He was using some absurd proprietal music making computer machine that barely like didn't function properly, but it was, you know, you know, it is, you don't have a lot of money, and he's like, this is the thing I have to make. So that's why his stuff, that's why it all kind of stutters and sits weird. Huh. And he was just like, oh, this is how I'm gonna make music.
That's crazy.
Oh yeah, the best sounds come from necessity.
Yes,
like that, like we you and I both know that from all the music we listen to. The best stuff is like the accidental, janky, held together with tape type of stuff.
Yeah, the accidents that happen that you don't clean up, or
you
know, I
or
you
don't have
agree.
The
yeah.
option of cleaning it up. You're just like, this is what we sound like,
right?
You
right.
know?
Yeah, I mean, that's very much in like also the punk like hardcore ethos of like, you know, doing everything yourself.
And, yeah, and not knowing the quote unquote right way to do things.
Yeah,
either because no one ever showed you, or because the right way requires equipment and expertise that you simply don't have.
Right. Well, yeah.
And then it's like, are we going to put this out perfect, or are we going to put this out?
Totally.
And I'll always take the I'll take the second one every time.
Yeah. Well, I feel like Grocer, to bring it back to them, has a lot of like, kind of like this frantic energy you can sense when you're listening to it.
Yeah.
That, because I mean, they track a lot of it live, so you can just really feel the room, I feel like, they're playing in.
And they played together for so long and under so many circumstances that like, that's a band that you want to track live in a room.
Oh, yeah.
You'd almost prefer it.
Yeah.
You'd never get that any other way.
That's crazy about Burial, though. I didn't know that. I've been listening to a lot of this artist Lee Gamble lately. I don't know.
Oh, no, I don't.
So you said Burial, so it reminded me of, it's essentially, that's the first artist reference point that came to mind was Burial. But, and I love this, it's called Models that he put out. And it's kind of, you know, fleeting, like disembodied, like voices, like kind of similar to Burial. But then I read that it was through a lot of like machine learning and AI to create these, you know, vocal patterns that you hear. But it was so confusing to me because I just thought it sounded so human.
Yeah.
And I was really just like kind of stunned by it, and still am. So maybe there is hope for like AI.
Yeah. I mean, I think if you continue to use it as a tool, I think of it, because I grapple with this, is I think, because like the podcast world's freaking full of this stuff now, like to the point where people are just like, we'll just get them to make them for us. And I'm just like, I'm out. If that, either that, or I'm going to be the weirdo, like still recording out of a bunker or something like that. Like, I was like, I don't, why would you want to shortcut the creative process? It makes no sense to me.
Right.
Both as a musician and as a guy who like a production person. Makes no sense. That's the most fun, is losing yourself in the mechanism of making something. Like I said, keeping your head down and just doing it.
I think so. I mean, I completely agree with what you're saying. That is the most fun, and that's what.
So to take it away, or to automate it, or to essentially farm it out, I don't understand that. Now, I'm not concerned with efficiency. Well, I'm concerned with efficiency to a point, but I'm not overly concerned with efficiency. I imagine you aren't either. So, like, I'm not trying to optimize any aspect of the production.
I'm happy, too, that, like, I will say this is still very much, if the label is a passion project, I feel I have another job, you know, a day job that.
Yeah. I have several.
And, so that I, to not having to have to compromise on, or not have to think about financial aspect so much, like it allows you to really do like focus on the artistic part of what you're doing, and
you get to make the choice of what do we like,
what
do we dig, what do we think sounds cool,
what
do we want to show everybody,
and
not worry about like, oh, do you think this will make money? Because my answer is like, no, I don't think it will.
Right.
There are very few things that I like that I think are gonna make money.
I know, it's that, and that's a rabbit hole I don't want to go down. And
no,
I'm glad I found that
out. Well, because I'll never be pleased. Like, I'll never get there, even if you get financial. And this is easy for us to talk about this because we've never gotten financial success from it. I'm sure if we did, we'd be singing a very different tune.
Right.
But, like, because I know, I've seen what happens with other people. It's never going to be enough.
Yeah. I feel very blessed to be able to, like, reinvest what we make back into projects that bring other people, you know, that give other people resources. And that's really the goal, and that will continue to be the goal. I remember just when I was in one, like, lecture at when I was at school, someone from, like, Interscope came in very much not focused on the art and was talking about how XBPM or, you know, lyrical topics or how to kind of piece together hits, like almost
like a formula.
Yeah.
Like
and,
a math
and
equation.
I was so confused. I was just like, cause I'm sitting there and it was helpful to know that exist. Like I just, not that I was naive to it, but to hear someone so blatantly just say that.
Well, there's someone to think that was going to work every time.
Right. But that was what he was concerned with too, which was confusing to me. I'm like,
he was concerned that it doesn't work every time.
Oh no. That just that he was concerned with, I'm just saying, making money. Obviously it's but I'm like, huh, you got into music. Like, what's the part about like the art or like what the artist feels or like, it just was so bizarre to me. And it still is. I think the music and there's so many different, like, I mean, the independent side of it is just, I hope it's not dying out, but
no, I mean,
it gets harder every year. I will say.
Oh, sure. I mean, and for what I do here too, because there's more music every year.
Yes.
And there's more, I don't know, podcasts, but like, cause there aren't more outlets. I learned this when I was trying to get press for the show leading up to the 300th episode, was that from a regional standpoint, I don't know who the heck to reach out to anymore that's not XPN or The Inquirer. One of those things will return my phone calls and the other one will not. I've cultivated enough relationships just out of mutual love of music.
Of course.
That I can go to people like XPN, like-minded people who are just like, oh yeah, this is cool. Yeah, we'll help you out. But like, I'm not saying that the music staff of the Inquirer doesn't care. I'm just saying they have a whole lot of other things that they have to care about, namely keeping that paper going.
Yes.
And whoever happens to own them this week or this month or whatever. Jeez.
Yeah.
But this was a town of two thriving alt weeklies once, and now they're nothing. Philly Weekly's a zombie site now.
Man, it is really.
You think that doesn't break my heart? Like when I think about it sometimes, because that was. Talking about an age, talking about being in your 20s, and you would go every week and you would get the two alt weeklies and you would sit wherever it was, your cafe job or like at work during your lunch break, and you would read them.
Yeah.
And you would see who's playing, what movies are out, books, restaurants, cool bars, interesting city political stuff that you didn't know about, written by someone who wasn't a mainstream journalist.
Sure, sure. Having that perspective was really valuable. I mean, it's been a bloodbath with press outlets.
It's gone.
I try not to dwell on like that tech has taken over music. And like, basically when I started the label, even like shortly after, I was like, these things, to do these things and work with these people, I know what a record can do if it's good, which I think it is. But now it's a little bit of like, you know, there's different types of value I feel like we're offering.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, even... you could work with a publicist and literally get nothing. Like it's just there's
and it's no one's fault.
It's no one's fault. Totally.
But it's always been like that. Yeah. I think there was just less of it. And if you got to a certain level, like I think even in the 90s, I think in the 90s, if you got signed to Matador Records, then like you knew a certain amount of things were going to happen.
Yeah.
Or a certain amount of opportunities would be presented to you to succeed at or not.
Mm-hmm.
And now it's like none of that.
Right.
Beware anyone who tells you what's going to happen.
No.
Because they're either as naive as you are or they're lying to you.
And and I'm not discouraging anyone from submitting demos ever, but there are times when people will, like, email me and I'm like, you don't need us right now. Like, keep doing what you're doing.
Because we're still operating under the model that, like, well, the next step is a record label. Yeah, it's like, sometimes not.
Yeah, sometimes not. I mean, if don't, you know, want to work with us just because we can maybe figure out how to make vinyl for you. Like, yeah. You know, you can figure that out on your own. Yeah. Like,
you'd be just as good as that on your own than by giving us some of it.
Yeah. But I do think there's, like, just the, I guess, bring it back to, like, the music I grew up, like, the hardcore stuff. There's a renaissance of that music happening right now. That's really exciting to me. I don't stay up to date, like, there's so many bands that even, like, every day there's a new band of young people playing that type of music. But, like, people are going to shows, like, in large numbers. And it doesn't matter if they're not, they don't have thousands or, you know, hundreds of thousands of streams. Like, it is kind of, I mean, that scene has always been, like, a live, you know, thing.
But it's always been a niche community that if you found it and you were inclined towards it, it was going to be your world. I mean, that's how we got into it.
Yeah. But I am happy to see that there are young people, like, discovering that and picking up instruments and playing.
Yeah, Find the thing that when someone hands it to you, you're just like, this, I will, for lack of a term, I will fuck up the rest of my life. Or I will make decisions for the rest of my life based on this. I go, if you find something, you're willing to be like, I don't care what it takes, I'm going to do that. Then that's your thing. Yeah.
That's a beautiful thing.
Yeah. And it's fun to be able to, for me to have found it later in doing this. And it's fun for you to be able to find that and to keep finding that in a record label, which is a incredibly thankless.
Thankless is the word. I was looking for that word before.
It's thankless and it's drudgery and it's the same thing every time.
Yeah.
But I get the different thing is the art, is the artist, is the music.
Yeah.
And to still be able to get excited about that. Because I will tell you, you at 34, it only gets harder to get excited. And that's not because the music is worse.
No, that's
a narrative that gets told, but it's incorrect.
I'm fighting the cynicism as much
too.
As I can.
Me too.
But
into
it,
my
40s, it is like
you
have to be mindful about it because I'm sure like it's easy to find yourself being like, well, this was better when I was younger, and it's just different. And certain things, you know, we have really strong memories attached to that are formative moments in our life where, you know, we can't believe like a young person is experiencing the same thing like through their screen or whatever. Yeah. But it's just a different experience. It doesn't mean it's bad.
The community is still there.
Yeah.
Like we talked about electronic artists who are able to just immediately put their stuff up onto SoundCloud and they all talk to each other on the internet. And I'm not going to say that's not a viable community. That's just what it is. That is another version of what it can be right now.
Because
I had the internet in the 90s too, like not to the level we had it now, but I had message boards and BBSs and chat boards and stuff like that. I mean, but that was what it was. Early days of MySpace.
Yeah, that was huge for me. MySpace, shout out. No, don't shout out.
It was a huge, it was like an MTV or something like that where it was for everyone. We could all access the same stuff. And then we could all feed into it at the same time as well. We could feed our bands and all our pages looked exactly the same. That's the best part. It didn't matter if you were on a major label or you were just some band from nowhere with 20 fans. On paper, you looked exactly the same. There's something to that democratization right there.
Were there play counts on MySpace? I was trying to remember this other day.
Yeah,
there were.
Absolutely.
Okay.
That's horrible, but
I feel like no one really cared about those. I mean, maybe we did, but to a lesser extent than we do now.
I don't know, because if I took the time to go to someone's page, it was because either I had heard them or someone told me I needed to hear them.
Right.
Or I read about them in an MP3 blog or something like that.
Yes.
And then I would go. So if I showed up and there's like 100 streams, 100 downloads, I'd be like, cool, looks like I'm 101.
Exactly. It wasn't like you're prejudging almost like subconsciously now when something has like not a lot of streams. But those were very formative days. MySpace, for my band at the time.
Yeah.
And
mine too. Yeah. We booked shows and like had a community based that way.
Yeah.
It's weird, but I'm with you where when I was your age, when I was in my mid-30s, I had to make a conscious effort to be like, I'm not going to be like that. I watch people, because that's when you start watching people your own age doing it. Not older people, people your own age. And it starts to freak you out a little bit.
Yeah. Listen, I mean, I'm not saying I relate to like everything. Like I can't put myself back in my 16-year-old body.
Some stuff is just not going to work for me.
Yeah.
Like some stuff does. like when Billie Eilish came out, like that worked for me. Like I was just into it. I was like moody two chord minor key.
It's good
stuff. I go, this is
really
great.
Good. Yeah,
I'm trying to intentionally watch things more and intentionally listen to things more, and not just turn on the thing that just does the thing.
Totally,
especially with music, because Spotify. They're like a drug dealer though. Like that Daylist thing.
Yo.
Oh fuck, man. Like I like it, but I can't. If I'm not careful, it's all I'll listen to.
I know.
I won't make conscious decisions about
the DJ too. The AI DJ. I made fun of it at first, and now I'm like, it's kind of amazing. Like I say that like begrudgingly because I really want. I am anti that. Like I want. I do set aside time to listen to records, and that's important. Yeah. But while I'm like cranking out work, like the AI DJ is just, it is like a drug dealer. Like,
well, it's just, they'll make it so easy.
They make it too easy.
So the Daylist, and then the Daylist will refresh itself midway through the day. So like I was listening to, it's like, oh, you're listening to 1950s era, you know, hard bop jazz. And now we've just slowly segued into all country singer songwriter. And I'm just, I don't even notice.
Yeah.
Which is messed up.
It is. I mean,
but you can also see how like publishing companies and record labels like play into that, and how they're getting like when the new Wilco album came out, it was peppering itself into every single one of my day lists. Yeah. And I'm just like, this is a stretch on some of this here. No shade on the new Wilco album. Right, I like it. Right. But
yeah,
it was getting fed to me constantly. This is not an accident.
Yeah, those things, it's not black or white. Like, because I do still use Spotify.
Oh,
I'm against a lot of what they, you know, are doing, as a theory, listener, though,
it's useful.
Yeah, it is still the problem is like the interface and the experience is too good, and Apple or another company is not really replicated
it's true. In the end, I just throw my hands up there and I do what you do, which I just put my head down.
Yeah.
And I'm like, well, let's make another episode.
Yeah. Is that the theme of this episode? I feel like it is.
No,
I relate to that very much. Or that's what I tell myself. Like, it's just, it's hard not to look at, you know, around you, who's doing something similar to, you know, why is this not as popular as that whole thing. But I do believe in just like staying. Yeah, it could take someone, a timeline for you might not be someone else's timeline.
Yeah.
And
you might not want the same things.
Yeah. And it doesn't mean your work is any less valid. So,
yeah.
You know who I got into recently? Do you ever listen to Talk Talk? Like, okay.
They
were like a blind spot for me. So I never listen to them.
Did you listen to Spirit of Eden for the first time?
Spirit of Eden, what's the last one? The one,
Laughingstock?
Laughingstock was incredible. I see a lot of what like The Smile is doing.
The first time I heard Spirit of Eden, I was just like, oh, this is why I like Radiohead.
Or that more.
Or like, it predates it. And like that record came out when those guys were in school.
Yeah.
You know those guys listened to that record.
Right.
You know they all sat around and are just like, oh my God.
And it sounds timeless. Like
fantastic.
Like listening to those two albums a lot lately. And so I got into Talk Talk more through Lee Gamble, that electronic musician who said that was a big influence of his, was Mark's solo record, actually. And I like found my way.
No,
going.
That's a great record too.
And I'm like, I love, when someone lists like inspiration from a completely different vibe or artist that you would think of, but I'm so happy I got into this, like went down this rabbit hole for Talk Talk.
Because it's great to still be able to do that.
Yeah. That's where it's really fun. That's when I feel like a kid again, is when I like find a band that I missed and I like dive into their discography and just get really, really stoked.
And that's the useful thing now, I guess, about some of the digital outlets is that now we're very blessed in being able to quickly do that.
Yes.
It's a good tool to have in the hand. It's also going to destroy everything. So here we are.
Depends what day or what side of the bed I wake up on.
Exactly.
But I'll try to end this on an optimistic note.
No, it's a good tool. Anything that democratizes something that was previously sectioned up, I think is a good thing.
Yeah.
Somehow.
How rights holders are compensated is a different story.
There we go. Yeah.
Okay.
Anyway.
I had to put it.
Spoken like a true label owner. Awesome. Jeremy, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you for having me. I really had fun. I appreciate it.
Well, that's the show for this week. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you to Jeremy Garber of Grind Select, an independent record label based here in Philadelphia, for coming, for talking. It was great. He reached out to me at some point, like maybe a month or so before he came over and talked. And it was great. Like I said at the beginning, I've always kind of known about this record label. And occasionally, you know, it would cross into my world with other bands that I knew. And just really, really awesome to talk to him. Really insightful guy. And, you know, 10 years of an independent record label. That's something. That's impressive. That is worth noting. Happy 10 years to Grind Select. Go to grindselect.com for all the information about their artists, their rosters, all the releases, things like that. Go to grindselect.bandcamp.com as well. That's how you can buy the stuff. Like I said, Philly bands including folks like Pine Barrens, Grocer, Sam Green, Sunstep, Nina Keith, Kerry Charles. I really do dig the new Kerry Charles record. Jeremy brought me a copy when he came to see me. He brought me some good swag. Look, I'm not saying that like he set the bar, but he kind of set the bar right there of awesome swag to bring me when you come to the podcast. That's not true. You don't have to bring anything. Just bring yourself. But hey, if you do bring things, they will not be refused. But yeah, he brought me the new Kerry Charles record. And I've listened to it a whole bunch of times. He brought me some other records too, but that one, I keep bringing that one back out. So good stuff there. Going to leave you with a new single from Grocer, actually. A song called Pack Rat from their forthcoming album, Bless Me, which comes out April 19th on Grind Select. Go to grindselect.com for all the information about that. But yeah, great tune, great band, great label, great talk with Jeremy. Really, really happy to have him here. So yeah, that's going to do it for this week. My name is Dan Drago. This is 25 O'Clock, Philadelphia's longest running music podcast, I think. Until next time, take care of yourselves. Enjoy this new single from Grocer. Eating